on stopping the desperation of immigrants. To do that, stop bombing their countries. And our videographer wants us to speak up, so I will try to do that. I'm Deborah Sweet, the director of World Can't Wait. I'm going to introduce very briefly the two panelists right now. On your right is Sally Latch, who's an artist, a world traveler. She's going to be speaking about working with refugees from the U.S. wars in Greece. And she's also a member of the Center for Global Justice in San Miguel de Allende, Mexico. And on your left is Ed Canan, who I know from the Upstate Coalition to Stop the Drones and End the Wars. Somebody who's been indefatigable in protesting U.S. wars for decades, but especially in focusing on the drone base that the U.S. maintains at Hancock Air Force Base in Syracuse, New York. And they both have a lot to bring to this. And I just want to introduce the topic today by noting that we're talking about principally the desperation of immigrants who have been created by the U.S. wars in the Middle East. We recognize very clearly that there are other forms of desperation that have been created by the U.S. global system of economic exploitation. The economic immigrants from around the world, the people whose countries and economies have been devastated by the U.S. global system in Mexico and Central America, many other countries. And there are the climate refugees, and this is, we don't have a lot of expertise on the climate refugees, but we understand that the global destruction of the climate at the hands of the big powers who are burning up at an increasing rate, and apparently in a way that literally glorifies the destruction of the planet, if you listen to Mr. Trump on Thursday, is creating refugees of another sort. A lot of what happened in Syria had to do with the drought in Syria. And there are lots of forces here. Here we live in the biggest economy, the imperialist center of the world, the biggest military power. And we feel that we have a huge responsibility to stop this degradation and destruction of the planet and this systemically built-in exploitation of people and countries that leads to people needing to come to this country just to try to survive. So I want to bring that in as background. The U.S. empire created something like 25 to 30 million refugees through its wars in the Middle East, the seven active wars right now. This is the war in, to occupy Afghanistan, Iraq, the support of the Saudis' attack on Yemen, the entering into Syria, the attack on Libya, the attacks on Somalia, which are really underreported and completely horrific through all sorts of secret operations. Gaza. Ed reminds me that Israel would not be in the position it's in to destroy the people of Gaza and the West Bank if it wasn't for the U.S. buildings. These are all situations for which we have ultimate and utter responsibility as people living in this country, and we have, I would argue, the most supreme responsibility right now to drive out the fascist regime that's taken over the White House. I am very clear, having spent the last 8 years before Trump, organizing people to stop the U.S. wars and the drone, the targeted killing and the drone wars that were taken to a whole new level by Obama and the Democrats in power. There is no doubt they have the blood of many thousands of people on their hands through the drone wars in Pakistan, Yemen, all the places that they carried out these secret operations. have to understand, people in the anti-war movement, that the Trump-Pence regime has and is taking us to a whole new level. The numbers of killings in the Middle East by U.S. action in the first 3 months of their regime tripled over what Obama was responsible for. This is Trump's action to take away the doctrine that everything has to be approved by the top and to give field commanders a great deal of discretion in unleashing bombs. This is Trump's action to drop the so-called mother of all bombs in Afghanistan, which had no legitimate military purpose, not to mention it was in contravention of all humanitarian and ethical standards. It was just to scare the globe. And you have a regime right now with its hands on the nuclear capabilities of the U.S., which are vastly over every other country, saying things in briefings before he took office, such as three times reportedly, "Hey, I don't get it. We have nuclear weapons. Why don't we use them?" This is who is in power right now. And I would argue that that situation and our relation to it as subjects of a fascist regime right now, in a moment that could be rapidly closing, given the nature of fascism, which is to suppress dissent, to stimulate the violent attacks on people, as we've seen all too horrifically in the last week with the Trump supporter slashing and murdering two men on the train in Portland who were speaking up for the two young women, one of them who was wearing hijab. We have many, many other incidents of this, and the characterization of Trump, of his enemies, Hillary Clinton, over the last 2 years should have told us a whole lot about understanding. If he's going to treat his opponent in a bourgeois election as someone deserving to be locked up and assassinated very explicitly, what is he going to do towards the millions of poor people, the millions of people disenfranchised, the political refugees, the people seeking solace, the people seeking just a place to live, coming from around the rest of the world? So a lot of what we'll be talking about today is this Muslim ban, the horrific violence now being instigated, I would argue, by the Trump-Pence regime quite explicitly, and then the set of laws and policies that the U.S. is implementing in these countries, against these countries, and then here locally. So I invite anyone who's interested in hearing further about this effort to drive out the Trump-Pence regime at the soonest possible time, ask me about it. It's not the main topic of what we're doing today, but I have to argue that anyone at the left forum right now who is thinking about humanity and wants to take the most significant action possible to act in the name of humanity has to go right up against the problem we have, that we've got to drive these people from power. Trump, Pence, everyone they brought into power, they have to go. So I would like to turn this over for a moment to Sally Latch, who's going to be showing a video, and you've been seeing some of the photos of her work with refugees, who can speak firsthand about interacting with refugees from the U.S. wars in Europe. And then Ed Command will speak, and then we'll basically have one big discussion. So again, thanks everyone for coming. This video is going to be available at worldcan'twait.net soon. So Sally.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I was in Greece for 8 months last year, and I was working with the refugees there, interviewing refugees and immigrants, international volunteers, and some Greek national people who gave so much of themselves in such a difficult time, and their own economic situation was so difficult. Before I go any further, though, I want to thank the Center for Global Justice in Mexico and all my friends there who made it possible for me to go to Greece and for me to be here now. I appreciate their efforts very much. So I'm going to be talking to you about a compilation of stories that refugees told me. These are not all the stories, but just some of them. So, on March 13, 2016, I arrived in Samos Island, Greece, and it was 1 week before the EU-Turkey deal that was devised to keep millions trying to escape death and destruction from entering Europe. These desperate people were trying to escape wars and economic exploitation, largely due to the meddling and deadly intrusions instigated and carried out by the US and its European allies. But I'm not here to talk about that. I'm here to paint a verbal picture of people just like you and me. People like get up in the morning, go to work, they come home, they cook dinner, they wash the dishes, they maybe watch a little TV, and they go to bed, and sometimes they get a toothache, and they go to the dentist. Just ordinary people, you know? These are people who are now living lives of untold misery. What does it look like? How does it feel? If it was you whose life was suddenly interrupted by bombs, rockets, gunfire, kidnapping, a home destroyed and everything gone, a child burned alive, a husband decapitated, a decapitated father and husband laid out in front of their house so the whole neighborhood could see it, so the wife and the children could see. And what if all your four children were blasted away by a barrel bomb? What would that feel like? What would it feel like to gather whoever was left of your family, collect a pair of socks, a t-shirt, a favorite family photo, put it in a little plastic bag to take with you, and say goodbye to all you had ever known and loved? Well, you seek safety, which means getting to the border, a death-defying feat, because the roads are blocked. You try to make your way through mountains of rubble, dodge the bullets fired by warring rebel groups, and hope you're not killed by bombs exploding around you. You pay a smuggler to lead you past ISIS or Taliban territory, and after many terrifying hours, somehow you arrive at the border. At last, you are safe. Well, not quite. After all, you don't have a visa. You don't have a passport. Of course, you can't enter. So sorry. You aren't wanted here. You aren't wanted anywhere. To make sure you know that a human-like monster with a gun pointed at you screams and dares you to enter his piece of the planet. You beg to cross into his space. He jams a rifle butt into your gut. An 8-year-old boy standing next to you is shot in the stomach. You watch as a stream of blood drips down his leg. He keels over. You panic. You try to help, but you can't. Your smuggler moves very fast and pays several hundred dollars to the guards, and he crosses over. Well, you're safe now. Where are you? Your smuggler, who is not your friend, and therefore can't be completely trusted. Leads you through a thick forest with wild animals and soldiers hunting you down. You follow him and trudge on quickly at night in total darkness. It's so dark, you can only know where to stop, step by following the sounds of those in front of you. If you travel in the winter, there is deep snow and freezing weather to battle. Your skimpy shoes and thin jacket won't keep away the icy cold and freezing wind until you get frostbite. You're weak. You falter and you fall. You lay there and watch as others move on. You force yourself up, stumble, and keep going. You pass a mother 8.5 months pregnant, lying helpless in the snow. She's alone with her 4 children. You want to help her, but you don't. You move on, passing dead bodies on the way. You feel guilty, but you must save yourself. You've been walking for 11 hours with no food or very little water and murderous soldiers to avoid. Maybe your daughters are not raped, but you're afraid your smuggler is part of a gang that wants to kill you, cut out your body parts for profit. They pay very well on the black market. Somehow you survive the journey and you decide to stop in Istanbul to earn some money. You need it because your wife is pregnant and waiting for you in Greece. You work 10 to 14 hour days doing dirty, hard work for about $1 an hour. You are illegal, so of course your employer will take advantage of this. He doesn't pay you, there's nothing you can do. But you continue, worried about your wife. Finally, you try to get to her. You try many times, but each time you're caught by the police. You are thrown in jail, beaten with clubs and kicked until you are covered in blood. They let you out and you try again. Each time you are arrested, put in jail, and beaten bloody, you keep trying. And finally, on the 10th try, you have dodged the bullets, the police, the thugs, and you reach Izmir, Turkey. Izmir, where smugglers hunt you down and entice you with the deal to get you to Samos. Samos, the Greek island where you will find your wife, and together you will make your way into Europe, the promised land. Well, next. The smuggler, for a price, arranges a small rubber dinghy, one that ordinarily holds about 20 people. Wanting as much money as possible, he forces up to maybe 50 people, maybe even more, into that space. You may refuse to get in, but the pistol he's waving at you changes your mind. Hopefully, the life jacket you bought is real, not filled with straw or styrofoam. You get in the dinghy. The smuggler stays on the shore. He points to a far-off light and he tells you to get to that. That's your destination. But you don't know how to steer the dinghy, and you've never even seen the sea before. You can't swim. Your children are crying. You're terrified. The dinghy is so crowded it sinks down to the waterline. Water gets in. The sea is rough and the boat rocks back and forth. It's pitch dark and you must not make a sound for fear of being caught by the police who are looking for you. Suddenly, the engine stops. It's run out of gas. You're going nowhere. So you wait in the blackness. You use the light on your cell phone, hoping rescuers from the Greek side of the sea will see you. But it's too late. The dinghy suddenly flies through the air, tipping over, trapping your beloved mother, your 2 sisters, and a brother underneath. They are devoured by the vicious, hungry sea. The next time you see them, they are mangled corpses washed up on the beach. Eventually, the Greek Coast Guard finds you, and they are kind and caring. They take you to the shore where police are waiting for you. They take your name, fingerprint you, ask a few questions, write something in a language you don't understand, and hand you a piece of paper. You are now registered. You are now officially an asylum seeker. An asylum seeker. Not the car mechanic, the hairdresser, the lawyer, the musician, the student, the housewife, the teacher, or whoever you used to be. You are put into a van and driven out of town far up a secluded hill. The van stops and you get out. You see a chain link fence topped up barbed wire dared to rip your flesh apart. Hundreds of people are inside, some clinging to the fence and shouting, "Salaam alaikum, my friend. Welcome to prison." Prison? Yes, prison. You're confused. You ask yourself, why am I in prison? What have I done? I didn't murder anyone, drop a 20,000-pound bomb on people, cut off heads, torture anyone. I didn't enslave workers. I didn't make deals with ISIS or the Taliban. I didn't sell weapons to hated dictators or to both sides of the conflict. Why am I being sent to this crowded, noisy, stinking place, a garbage pit, made for 400, now crowded with over 2,000 desperate, hopeless men, women, and children who stand in line for hours to get an insect-infested, slimy pasta and potatoes and wait months, if not years, to learn if they will be granted asylum or be sent back to Turkey and to prison. Some choose suicide. I have been told by my friends who are still there that they found a man hanging, trying to kill himself, hanging from a tree. Somebody else tried to burn himself alive. The gate is slammed shut behind you for days. It will take weeks before you realize what has happened to you. What has happened to you is that forces beyond your control have visions of power and conquest, to say nothing of untold riches. In the process, millions have been displaced, killed, drowned, but it doesn't matter. They are high officials in far-off places in fine suits, posing and grinning for photo ops. They aren't concerned about you. They are concerned about getting elected, getting promoted, saving their jobs and their influence. They gather together and drum up fears about you, your religion, your strange form of the world, and destroy us. You are the dreaded enemy, the terrorists, to be feared, to be kept in your place, to be locked up, to be drowned. How else can we maintain our perfect culture, our very civilized way of life? How else can those in power stay there? Now, we're going to play one part of an interview that I did with a Syrian mother who traveled with her three children. And she was one of those people that was afraid that her daughters might be raped on the way, or that they might be, their guts might be harvested.
Hello, I am a Syrian woman, a mother of three children, a son and two daughters. I lived as anybody else, normal life in Syria. I had a husband, I had a house, I had work, and everything was okay before the revolution. I love my country. I'm proud of my country. I'm proud to be Syrian. After the revolution, we suffered a lot. As people, we suffered a lot from everything. We suffered from murder. We suffered from kidnapping. We suffered from poverty. Actually, we had nothing to do with the war. It wasn't our choice. We didn't want this to happen, but it happened against our will. I don't know how to say it. All the Syrian people like their country, and we try to stay there, hoping to finish, but it took a very long time, years, not only days, not only months, it was years, 5 years right now. We are facing poverty, facing fear. For me, it was really difficult. As a mother, if I want to buy anything to send my son or my daughter, I am waiting, looking at my watch, counting the minutes, waiting for them to come back. And sometimes I expect not to come back. Maybe a bomb, maybe kidnap, maybe someone will shoot them. I don't know. Different ways of death. I lost my husband. I don't know where he is right now. A year ago, he went outside to work like any man, but never come back. I lost connection with him. So I had to go on living with my three kids. My health was getting worse and worse. No doctors, no medicine. And even if there is a doctor or medicine, there is no money. It became really, really very expensive. So the responsibility was doubled for me as a mother and as a sick woman. So I had to have a choice to save the lives of my children. In Syria, I was expecting death anytime for anyone in my family. So I decided to take them and run away from my country. Although it was really a bad feeling for me to leave everything I built in my life, my house, my memories, my family, my friends, I left them all. But I have to keep my children safe. I was looking for them, for safety, keep them away from danger. So I decided to take them and run away. And it was really a bad trip to go out of Syria, a sick woman with her kids, climbing the mountains with a smuggler. I don't trust, I don't know. We were passing through the cities of Syria, among parties, fighting, I don't know who with whom. I was just keeping my eyes closed. I don't want to see anything. I just want to go out of Syria, keeping my children between my arms. And the trip at that time hasn't finished yet. I still have to face the fear of the sea. In the sea, it was really a horrible thing. A month before deciding to go by sea, I was imagining the whole night, I don't sleep, imagining that I have three kids who will be drowned, and if someone is drowned, whom to save? Shall I save the young or the old? It was difficult thinking that I am the mother, I'm responsible for them. If I die, what will happen to my children? So, for my little girl, she doesn't speak English or she doesn't know. I started writing her name and a number of telephones in case I die, so they can contact my relatives. I don't know, many, many ideas passed in my mind, and to go in the sea, it was really a very, very bad thing. I hope nobody go through it. In the boat, I couldn't look into the eyes of my daughter, so that not to see the fear in her eyes, and also not to see the fear in my eyes at the same time. It's really difficult to give her the feeling that everything is okay while I am really very much afraid. So it's not something easy for us to leave our country after 5 years. I don't know how to explain it. I got my memories, my country, between my hands for 5 years, but no longer. It's difficult after 5 years. We need to live as humans. It's difficult to think for my son to be killed or my daughter, someone I don't know how.
I want to say that, you know, these people shared their most personal, deepest feelings, their fears, their terror, their hopes, their despair. We hugged and we cried together. These people stay in my heart forever. I'm still in contact with them, and I communicate with them every day. So their horrors just continue. They shared their feelings with me, their stories, and I'm sharing them with you. And I hope that you can take them into your heart as well. And perhaps we can be spurred on to take whatever action is needed to bring some justice and peace that we all need. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Stopping the desperation of the refugees who were created by the actions of the U.S. forces in the Middle East in particular, and we do recognize that there are other refugees, not our expertise, but we're speaking to this particular yawning, horrible world problem right now. And I want to introduce Ed Kanan, who again is from Syracuse, New York, the Upstate Coalition to end the drones and stop the war. Or maybe it's the other way around, but either, they both got it.
Yeah.
Thanks, Ed.
Yeah. Well, it's kind of hard to follow Sally's presentation of the desperation. So I think we're fortunate to be able to hear about the desperation. And really, it's going to be hard to forget. So within this framework, I call my remarks the war on terror. Are we the terrorists? The focus of my activism over the years has been anti-militarism. More recently, I've come to see myself as a counter-terrorist. Given that the tactics used in the huge number of civilians slaughtered and displaced in our multiple ongoing wars, militarism and terrorism have an immense overlap. Terrorism, if honestly defined, is a major element of militarism. It is also a major element of the past 5 centuries of European global expansion. How we define terrorism indicates whether we favor that expansion or deplore it. Most of us here in the U.S. are raised to think of such expansion as progress, the spread of civilization. Hey, who can argue with white privilege and white supremacy. But given the toll that the spread of a civilization has taken on human beings and on nature, many critical thinkers and people of conscience deplore it. And I count myself among them. Just as history tends to be written by the victors, so the manipulated and much understood concept of terrorism tends to be defined by those who control the narrative, and defined by those who control the most devastating means of terrorism, nuclear and otherwise. Those controllers also tend to define when the narrative begins, thereby excluding whole swaths of history. This buried history could explain why some of those called terrorists do what they do. Case in point, the Israeli colonial settler state, founded on terrorism and engaged in ongoing, generations-long ethnic cleansing. They use the term terrorist to define, defame, and demonize those whose land it occupies, Palestinians. And U.S. pundits and politicians and corporate control of mainstream media systematically tilt the concept terrorism and counterterrorism toward the imperial version of history. Thanks to Israel's militarized expansionism, since the 1940s, Palestine has become essentially a refugee state. Its people scattered to Gaza, the West Bank, refugee camps in neighboring countries, and across the planet. Today, Syria is likewise another bomb-targeted, scattered refugee nation. My sensitivity to terrorism in part comes from having lived in Baghdad during the U.S. invasion of Iraq. Shock and awe is how the Pentagon publicists triumphantly described its air war that pulverized homes and markets and infrastructure, not to mention human flesh. In 2003, I was in Baghdad for 5 months with Kathy Kelly's group, Voices in the Wilderness. Our team was there in solidarity with the Iraqi people, doubly oppressed by their government and by ours. Voices in the Wilderness brought medical supplies to Iraq in defiance of U.S. enforced sanctions. Those forbade importing medicine and other survival essentials into Iraq. In the 90s and early 2000s, according to the UN, those sanctions caused several hundred thousand children to suffer premature death. Those sanctions were systematic, systemic violence. They were both a tactic of militarism and a kind of terrorism, i.e., violence against civilians for political purposes. And we'll refine that definition shortly. As life in Iraq became unsupportable and extremely dangerous, many Iraqis, like the aforementioned Palestinians and Syrians, became displaced people, refugees, both internally and abroad. Those U.S. sanctions, both systemic and heartless, were only one aspect of what is this bloody planet's major form of terrorism, state terrorism, a concept politicians, pundits, and mainstream media choose not to grasp. Those few but very long weeks of shock and awe were a more emphatic kind of state terrorism. Of course, here in the U.S., the slaughter was never called that. For the Pentagon, mass indiscriminate killing has long been both idealized and normalized. Think of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, or Vietnam and Laos, or more recently, Libya, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Somalia, and other Islamic countries. Al-Qaeda and ISIS match the Pentagon in their disregard for human life. But they're pikers compared to the Pentagon's high-tech and capital-intensive killing. For the past three-quarters of a century, state terrorism has featured aerial terrorism. That's the submarine-launched cruise missiles, or the bombs and missiles delivered by aircraft, either manned or unmanned. By unmanned, I'm referring to the robotic killer drones now terrorizing Yemen and other Islamic-majority countries. Aerial terrorism is cowardly. Typically, it kills with no warning, with no due process, without knowing or caring who its victims are. Nor do drone assassinations distinguish between civilians and combatants. Often drones violate sovereignty and operate outside the bounds of legally declared war. Since the 1940s, aerial terrorism has mostly been perpetrated by the U.S. and its allies, proxies, puppets, and arms customers. Recently and repeatedly by Israel and Gaza, and currently by Saudi Arabia and Yemen. While in Iraq in 2003, with dread, we would dive to the floor as shells and missiles screamed overhead, exploding nearby. People right across the street were killed. Funny thing, our mainstream media certainly never described shock and awe as aerial terrorism. If they had, it would have exposed just who the real terrorists were. The lesson I learned in Iraq was that one's definition of terrorism depends on whether one was with those launching the missiles or whether one was their target. Whether you're a fish swimming free or a fish on the hook, you might see things differently. Certainly the fish on the hook will see things differently from the guy holding the fishing pole. In the mid-70s film, Jaws typified our world. I didn't see it, so I'm basing it on its reputation. Jaws demonized sharks while falsifying the human shark reality. Some humans profit by harvesting shark fins. Animal protection groups estimate that for every human attacked by a shark, this is worldwide, 1 million sharks are killed by humans. But who gets to demonize whom? If they could, how would sharks define human predation so severe that some shark species are at risk of extinction? In the mainstream mind, whether an act or atrocity is terrorist doesn't depend on the act itself, but rather on who is pushing the button, who is gripping the joystick, or who the suicide bomber is. Further, the label terrorist also depends on who the victims are. For example, which of the three patriarchal religions they relate to, Christian or Jewish or Muslim, or whether the demographic is European-derived or indigenous. Those natives, after all, simply don't count. Sometimes it seems to boil down to where on the white and not-so-white continuum the perpetrators or victims find themselves. For the past five centuries, much of the world's terrorism has been colonial or settler terrorism. But during those centuries, settlers, colonialists, corporations, and the state have controlled the narrative by controlling or buying official and mainstream media, which means these powerful players control the very definition of terrorism. From the imperial point of view, terrorism is a specific complex of traits. It is violence perpetrated by non-state, non-uniformed actors. And although this typically isn't acknowledged, those actors are often in their home territory, invaded by foreign others. Take Iraq, take Afghanistan. The terrorism that gets named is retail, not wholesale, low tech, not high tech, shoestring, not capital intensive, land based, not aerial, but typically gets named terrorism is violence by non-whites directed at whites. For example, indigenous people targeting settler colonials or corporations seeking to drive them off their land or seeking the oil beneath their land. The U.S. State Department has defined terrorism as, quote, violence or the threat of violence against civilians for political purposes, unquote. That's a useful and objective definition, but only goes halfway. The definition leaves out what might be terrorism's most crucial aspect, economics. This more rounded view, it's clear, with this more rounded view, it's clear that the United States itself was founded on terrorism. The cultural and biological genocide of those occupying this continent by those arriving from across the sea with more horrific weapons. The U.S. generated vast numbers of what we would now call refugees as Indian nations were decimated and displaced further west toward the sunset. Simultaneously, whites abducted vast numbers of Africans, forcing them to work on the stolen, vacated land. In the 21st century, that regime, gone global, is imposing on the planet the only good engine is a dead engine, Islamophobic definition of terrorism. One evening last fall, post-election, on remarkably short notice, tens of thousands simultaneously showed up at the airports across the U.S. In my hometown, about 1,000 of us converged on the Syracuse International Airport. We were protesting Mr. Trump's unconstitutional ban on travelers and refugees from 7 Islamic majority nations. Probably few of my fellow demonstrators were aware that next door to our airport and sharing some of its facilities is Hancock Air Base. Hancock is the home of 174th Attack Wing of the New York National Guard. The 174th operates MQ-9 Reaper drones 24/7 over Afghanistan and probably elsewhere. With its typical bloodlust, the Pentagon calls the Reaper a hunter-killer drone. That weaponized robot terrorizes people, sending them fleeing from their homes, depopulating whole villages. No doubt those Hancock Reapers displaced some of those refugees for whom people of the U.S. were demonstrating support. There's an excellent source documenting this refugee-generating drone terror. It's the Stanford and NYU report, and NYU Law School report, called Living Under Drones, which you can download for free. I encourage you to learn more and download its 165 pages. doing their jobs that work. By way of concluding these remarks, let me plug another panel, also organized by World Can't Wait, by Deborah and Stephanie, who do all this legwork and background work to get us all together, and been doing it for years. It's happening here tomorrow, noon, in room 1101. The panel is called War on the World, Trump Style. I'll be reporting there on what a small grassroots group called, well, some is called Upstate Joint Action, others call it by, you know, Deborah's...
I'm the official name, right? I freelanced it.
Yeah.
It's anyway. About war and drones, I gotta be stopped.
Yeah, basically, yeah, that's the rest of it. We formed back in 2010 to expose the scourge of weaponized drones. We've been waging a 7-year-long, largely unknown, direct action campaign right outside the main gate of Hancock Air Base. Our actions have been colorful, creative, nonviolent, and persistent. They've led to a couple of hundred arrests, and to many trials and incarcerations. Upstate Drone Action wants the taxpaying public and Hancock drone personnel to realize they are cogs in an apparatus of terror. Please join us tomorrow noon.